Blessed is the man who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers. But the man who delights in the law of the Lord and meditates on his law day and night, he is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yield its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does, prospers.
Good morning. It's good to see everybody here this morning. My name is Pat. I'm the student minister and next-gen pastor here at our church. Wayne is obviously not here this morning. He's at our Five Forks campus this morning, and he thought, who do people connect with the most on staff? And so we had Bob preach the first service and Dan preach the second service. And so y'all are stuck with me, and so I apologize for that. But man, it's great to be here. I will say, so out at Five Forks campus had their official location launch this morning, and they had 210 present out there. Isn't that incredible? I think that's pretty awesome. And we had baptism at Harrison Bridge this morning and downtown, which, man, God is on the move in our church, y'all. It's a pretty exciting thing to see. It's a pretty exciting thing to be a part of. And so I'm honored to be a part of it, and glad to be here with you this morning. I know Wayne wishes he could be here. He always feels torn when he does that sort of thing. You can always see the inner battle in his mind when he's like, I want to be in two places at once. And so I had the privilege of listening to Bob, and then I snuck in and listened to a little bit of Dan's message. So y'all get really some of the bits and pieces of all those this morning. If you want to turn your Bible, you can, to Acts chapter 2. Today we're going to talk about community in this Rooted series, what it means to be truly rooted and foundational and healthy, right? If you've ever had a tree that wasn't rooted well, it doesn't last long. The wind comes, blows it over, or a storm. And so what we want to do is be rooted so deep that the things that you don't see in our lives, those parts of our lives that maybe other people don't even see if you pulled the curtain back a little bit, are so deep that it gives us strength above ground. And so this series is all about really those types of things. And so today we're talking about community. And I saw some of these things that I thought were worth sharing, that people who are isolated but healthy are twice as likely to die over a period of a decade as those that aren't isolated. Living alone after a heart attack significantly increases the risk of dying. People with heart disease have a poorer chance of survival if they're unmarried or don't have a partner to assist them. Women who are alone and have breast cancer live half as long as those who don't. People with malignant melanoma who participate in group intervention live longer than those who don't. People who have cancer who participate in group intervention literally live longer. And you're like, well, what is that all about? Why would that be a reason? Why would that happen? It's because God has created us for community. God has built in the heart of every single one of us in here this morning the need for community. We are not meant to live life alone, because you start talking to volleyballs at that point, right? And they start becoming your best friends. If any of y'all ever seen Tom Hanks's famous movie, right? But like, we have to have community. Who cried when Wilson floated away? Sorry if I'm ruining that, but I'm like, Wilson, he's gone, right? Like, it's terrifying, right? But like, we're built for community. We're built for the need for relationships in our lives. And here's something just I want to start off with, is that community shapes us. Relationships shape us. If you want to see the kind of person you're going to be in 10 years, show me the people you're hanging out with. If you want to see somebody where they're going to end up, show me the kind of people that influence their lives. You can often even ask a pastor the same thing, what kind of preacher are you? And you say, well, what are the preachers you listen to? Because the reality is, community shapes us. The people that we surround ourselves with and that we spend a lot of our time with, that invest in our lives and we invest in their lives and vice versa, are shaping who we're becoming. They're determining the direction of who we're going to be. I tell our students all the time, you don't know where you're going to be in 10 years or 20 years. None of us really do. We can guess. But you can determine who you're going to be in 10 years or 20 years. And community is a large part of what God is using to help shape who we're becoming. When I was in 11th grade, I got saved. That's when I became a Christian. I was 11th grade. And I was with my group of guys. They kind of became a close-knit group. And at the end of that 11th grade year, we decided, like, let's do something fun together. You know, what would we do? And I don't know. We didn't have Gravitopia, and we didn't have go-karts that went, like, 50 miles an hour like we do these days. This was the dark ages, right? This is the 90s, all right? There was no internet. You couldn't Google and find out. Well, I guess you could Google, but Google was different, okay? We had actually heard of an older group one time that had a used Christmas tree sale for our music minister on New Year's Day, and we thought that sounded like a lot of fun, so we decided to throw him a yard sale. Y'all ever been to yard? You got some yard sale people out here? Some of y'all? Okay, my mom loves yard sales, all right? So I grew up, like, hitting up yard sales with her, and, like, the one day a week you want to sleep in, Saturday, she's like, get out of bed, we're going to yard sales, right? Got to get there early. Got to beat everybody else to all the junk that people don't want anymore in the front yard, okay? We decided we were going to throw our music minister a yard sale. And so I put an ad in the paper that this yard sale was going to start at 6 a.m. And for like 3 weeks, we collected as much junk as possible. One day I was riding down the road, and we saw a dishwasher on the side of the road. We started to load it up in the back of my car. It had a Buick. All right, Buick LeSabre, 1988, loading this dishwasher in the back of my Buick. That totally looks sketch. Like, let's just be real. If you saw a couple teenagers grabbing stuff off the street, and this guy rolls up, he's like, y'all looking for junk? And we're like, yeah, what you got? He had like a big freezer, he had some beds, he had all kinds of stuff. So we brought a trailer over to his house, loaded that trailer up. We had four truck beds and a trailer full of junk. I had a washing machine that when you opened the top, it was just the ground below it. I don't know what happened to the rest of the washing machine. We had a shell. We had a washing machine shell. And so I put a sign on there, needs work, right? Because it did. It did need some work. And then we made a sign that's like ring bell for service, right? Like one of them ring the doorbell for service. I don't know if anybody actually did that or not. But at like midnight, right, we decided we're going to go load all this stuff out there at midnight because he had no clue it was coming, if you haven't picked up on that yet. And so we had four truck beds and a trailer full of stuff. And at midnight, we decided if we're going to get caught, only half of us are going to get caught. So we had two shifts, and we had little radios back and forth. And, one group would go and empty a truck, and we'd be like, they're on their way back. It's our turn. And we would go, and we'd empty a truck. And so we did these little shifts, and we covered his front yard with junk. I mean, it was stuff everywhere. I mean, it was embarrassing to all of us, but we were also very, very excited. It was a very memorable moment for us as 11th grade guys. Now, I'll just, like, pause at this moment of the story to say, I have cameras outside of my house and have had cameras outside of my house for probably, I don't know, Mel, 8 years or something like that. So, just saying I got cameras and can catch anybody. I've already caught people. Just saying. All right, so we put all this stuff in the front of Gary's house, and we left. And the downside of this prank was that we didn't actually get to see his face when he woke up in the morning and walked outside and saw his front yard full of junk. And people nonstop coming by, because again, ad in the paper. Papers were these things that people used to read. They were like news, you got your news there, and people went there for. So it was a pretty exciting time. But those relationships, those friendships shaped who I became. In fact, out of my friend group in high school, I got saved, like I said, halfway through my junior year, and that friend group that I connected with, 11 of us went into ministry out of that group. I mean, it was really cool to see how God was shaping us and molding us, and the people that I surrounded myself with, the people who were pouring into my life, was the community that was shaping who I was becoming. I want you to know this. Character cannot be developed in isolation. Character cannot be developed in isolation. You have to have people that are willing to look you in the eye and say hard things. That's what community is all about sometimes. You ever had that person that you like, and sometimes you don't want to be around because you know they're going to ask you the hard question, right? Some of them might sell life insurance. I don't know. I'm not digging on life insurance people, but they're all like, hey, did you have life insurance? You're like, yes, I do, even if you don't. But at the end of the day, like, we don't always want somebody that is going to look us in the eye and call us out and tell us hard things. Today, we're going to read in Acts chapter 2 about the early church, really how this community as we know it began to form. And so the exciting part for me as we read this is that God really, through the scriptures, I think empowers his people, empowers the church. In the Old Testament, if you look, when he started, Moses led people out of slavery because of God. God said, tell them, let my people go. Moses goes, leads them out. You remember this whole water splitting, wandering in the desert type of thing. And they build this tabernacle. They build this temporary solution to actually commune with God, to have this opportunity to have sacrifices that took place so that they could know God, because God designed us to be in community with himself. In fact, God is in community as the Trinity. And so he's designed us to be in community with him, to have a relationship with him. And so this tabernacle that would travel around, that they would pack up and move whenever they had to move, God had specific guidelines. And you can go back to the Old Testament and read that. And then they built a temple for God to be able to meet with his people. They built this temple that people would go to, Jewish people would go to. They would have their sacrifices. Priests on their behalf would be that intercessory person that would be able to talk to God, to be able to take what their needs to the Lord, right? And there was this whole kind of situation that happened in the temple that allowed people, that allowed us to have community with God. And what's beautiful about when Jesus came and when Jesus died on the cross, the veil in that temple that separated man from God was torn in two. It was literally ripped in two. I'd have liked to have been there for that moment. Would have been a pretty exciting thing. Was ripped in two because God says now it's not about the tabernacle, it's not about the temple, it's about the church. That God's indwelling us. He lives inside of us. You don't need a priest to act on your behalf. We're not priests on the staff, right? You don't have to come to us and say, if you don't mind telling the Lord, I need a new car, right? Like, we don't have to do that for you. You can meet with the Lord right where you are. The Bible says you are a priest. That's kind of a cool thing, right? Put that on your Instagram. I'm a priest. But, like, that's kind of a cool thing. When he talks about the church word, if you go back to the original language, is ekklesia. It means called out, assembly. So in the Old Testament, it was a people. In the New Testament, it's a body. He's designed the church to function as a body, and he indwells us. In fact, the early church was kind of known as the way. That's how they referred to themselves, was the way. It was the way of Christ, the way they did it. But the term is koinonia, having everything in common, having a share in with one another. This idea of community was not just, hey, I want you to come to a service. I want you to attend this group. I want you to do this thing. I want to make sure you give. I want to make sure you sing. I want to make sure you sit and listen to some bald guy talk for like 25 minutes. Like, it wasn't that. It was, we all have a share in, we have a community, we have something in common that we are pitching in and caring about one another. It was more than that. It was a beautiful thing. Now, when we say the word church, to me, there's like church in two different ways. If you think about it, if you read scripture and you see church with a big C, that means capital C, that's our church, like global. That's like church across the world. Anybody who is a believer is a part of the church, right? They're part of what God is doing. So I know sometimes we kind of separate ourselves from other churches. We got a church across the street. We got one down the road. We got one down that way, like three down this way. We've got churches all directions, but those are churches little c. That's the local expression of that community. When we see church big C, we mean like the global church. And what's beautiful about the body of Christ is that I can go to Thailand, as we did last summer with our seniors, which was an incredible trip, and we can meet other believers in Thailand, and we're part of the same church. We're part of that same body that God's called us to. But God has called us to engage in the local church, little c. He's called us to engage in community, people that we interact with on a relatively active basis. The book of Acts is widely known genre as a historical book. This is simply, in many ways, almost a sketch of how the early church came to be and the things that they experienced. And obviously, chapter 2 is kind of near the beginning. Luke, writing this, is almost writing it as an extension of his gospel. So he writes his gospel to tell about Jesus and the things that Jesus did and said, and then he writes the book of Acts to talk about the Acts of the Apostles, which is where we get the name, or really what's happened since then. What is God doing through the church since that moment? So we've seen many signs and wonders already happening. What's amazing, if you go back and read even in the early chapter of chapter 2, you see that Peter's preaching, and he's preaching to 17 different people groups. I don't know how many languages are represented there, but 17 different people. And he speaks in a way that everybody hears it in their own language. That's pretty amazing if you think about it, because I feel like I repeat myself a lot with people anyway, right? Like, you don't understand my English, and I'm from Middle Georgia. I get that. But, like, 17 different people heard it in their own language. And The Bible describes it as a ministry of tongues, but it's probably more accurately described in this instance as a ministry of ears, right? Gift of ears. God used Peter in such an amazing way to share the gospel in a clear way, to talk about the fact that Jesus came, the one that we crucified. Jesus went willingly to the cross and gave up his life so that we can be indwelled and be the church, so that he can save us and redeem us. And so that brings us to Acts chapter 2, verses 42, because at this point it says 3,000 people got saved from that one sermon. I think every pastor has kind of been like living that down ever since, right? We're like, come on, man, let's get 3,000. Let's beat Peter's record. But like, man, it's amazing that 3,000 people decided to follow Jesus. I don't know how many thousands of people were there, but 3,000 people over 17 different people groups decided to follow Jesus. And so it brings us to verse 42, is really this kind of amazing discovery of all of these new Christians trying to figure out what to do, trying to figure out how to live. You know, the early Christians, after Jesus died and resurrected, they were almost dumbfounded. Like, wait, what? They did not see that coming. They did not see the story that God's unfolded that we look back on. They didn't see it coming when it came in the first place. And so these new Christians are honestly kind of like, hey, what should we do? And they're like, man, I don't know. We're trying to figure this out ourselves, right? Like, our Savior, like, we didn't even realize he was going to die. And then he's resurrected. And now this whole thing's happened. Now there's 3,000 of you. You know, we joke around, like, where there's, you know, two Baptists, there's five opinions. And so I don't know what it meant when you had 3,000 brand new people coming in, and they're like, this is how I think we should do it, right? But we're going to read a few things. And there's seven things in here that they were marked by, and I'm going to try and run through them as quickly as possible. Before we do, I would like to read these five verses. It says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. The first thing I want to mention this morning is that they were marked by the word. If you read in verse 42, it says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Now, I think this is an interesting word. I love how Bob even challenged us in the first morning, devoted. It didn't mean that they just kind of casually approached this. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Short side note tidbit just for you, all right? This is free. An apostle is someone who's seen Jesus. A disciple is someone who follows Jesus, all right? So we're all disciples if we're following Jesus, but you're not an apostle unless you've seen Jesus in the flesh, okay? And so these people were apostles. They were people not only had the clout that they were disciples, people who followed Jesus around and got to know him, they were apostles. They were in the presence of Jesus. So it's important to note that really at the beginning, because those 3,000 people who devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, it wasn't just somebody who stood up and said, I think I can figure this out. It was the guy who was like, no, I've been with Jesus. This is what Jesus told us to do. And as we know, the New Testament was written by the apostles, because inspired by God, but through the apostles. So they devoted themselves to the word. 3,000 new converts, 3,000 new people who needed instruction to become effective witnesses. They knew what it meant. The early church was riddled with persecution. I mean, the disciples, in fact, you skip ahead two chapters, you see the disciples are beaten almost to the point of death for preaching about the gospel. So now you have thousands of people who are joining them, I mean, flooding this temple on a daily basis to worship Jesus, the one who Jews had crucified, the one who literally has risen again. And they're showing up. These religious leaders of that day had no clue what to do with them. They became more than converts. They became disciples because they devoted themselves to the word. I want you to know, like, our church, we stand on the Word of God. We believe the Word of God is perfect. We believe the Word of God is right. I tell people all the time, I disagree with God often. I just know I'm the one that's wrong. You ever read the Word and you're like, I don't like that? You don't change God's opinion, right? God changes your opinion. The reality is that we stand on the Word of God. It's how we know His will. It's how we know what authority should be in our lives. Well, God doesn't speak on this specific issue. I bet he does. I bet God can use his word to direct you to follow him. The reality is, God's word is where we stand. And it's important for us to know it. It's important for us to dig in. It's important for us to devote ourselves to know God's word. If you don't know God's word, you will be influenced by a whole bunch of other thoughts and ideas. It's why it's so important for us, by the time we send students out to go to college, that they have had an opportunity to know the word of God, to understand the gospel. We just spent 4 weeks on Wednesday nights explaining in clear terms what the gospel is. I'm gonna challenge you just to find one of our teenagers and ask them, explain the gospel to me, because I'm curious, and I'm putting y'all on the spot now. But I'm curious if they're able to do it, because we actually, I gave away candy, so I had some bribery, but I would be like, who wants to come share this? And we had hands going up everywhere to come on stage and explain the gospel to their peers. What a beautiful thing, what an incredible thing that we would know the word of God, that we would know why we're here. Otherwise, why are we here? The word must come first. We're unified by the word. 2 Timothy 2:1 and 2 says, "You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Jesus, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." They took this literally, saying, we are going to make disciples of disciples. We're going to teach them the word. We want them to entrust that into other people. The second thing that we're marked by is fellowship. It says that they devoted themselves to apostles' teaching and the fellowship and to the breaking of bread. I think when we use the term breaking of bread, we typically mean the Lord's Supper. It's probably when we hear that term. It's not necessarily in our vernacular that I'm aware of. Maybe it is. For most of us, like, we're not like, hey, let's break bread at Taco Bell today. Like, most of us aren't doing that kind of lingo. But when we say that, that's what we mean. In this case, it wasn't as much about them taking communion, although that was part of it. It was more about just the fact that this was saying they were doing life together. They're having meals together. They were looking across the dinner table while they were eating and talking about their day, talking about what the Lord was teaching them, talking about the way God was growing them. Community is about fellowship. It's how we relate to each other. It's the fact that we need each other. That's a hard thing to really say, because a lot of us don't want to need anybody. I got this. But we need fellowship in our lives. We need other people that we can break bread together, that we can do that. You know, we talk about the church as it's this building. And we'll refer to this building as the church. Right, and then we've got Upstate Church Harrison Bridge and Upstate Church Five Forks, and then Upstate Church fill in the blank for all the other campuses that are in our vision, because they're going to be all across the upstate. But man, we oftentimes talk about this building as a church, but this building is just a building. And if it burns down tomorrow, the First Baptist Church Simpsonville still exists. We're still a church, because the church is the people of God. And we need one another. We need to build into one another. We need to care about one another. We need that fellowship. It's through that fellowship that we learn from one another. I've learned a lot of things from you guys just in the 3 years that I've been here. I've learned a ton of things. In fact, did you know that if you go to Sam's Club, Cocoa Puffs has marshmallows? I learned that like 2 weeks ago. That's incredible from somebody in church. Y'all are like, that's not spiritual at all. It's not, but it's spiritual to me. Okay, because I love my Cocoa Puffs, and now I have them with marshmallows, and it's like, the bag is like this big, okay? So it's another thing to be excited about. But we need each other so much that Matthew 5 actually challenges us that if we have a problem with our brother, we can't even fully worship the Lord right. So I don't want to be that like guy that Jesus jukes people. You ever use that phrase, Jesus jukes? It's like, somebody's like, what's the best book you've ever read? And you're like, the Bible? That's a Jesus juke. All right, most people don't like that. I'm not telling you to Jesus juke your friends, but if somebody's complaining about somebody, I don't care who it is, fill in the blank, just ask them, have you talked to that person about this? Have you dealt with it? Because you can't worship the Lord until you've dealt with that. I'll be honest with you, bitterness only hurts the person who's bitter. The person who you're bitter against probably didn't lose an ounce of sleep over it. And yet you're over here stirring about it. Fellowship requires us to be in right relationship in order for our relationship with God to be right. John 13 even challenges this way. A new command I give to you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. He didn't say, love the people like you. He says, love one another. And this is the key. By this, all men know you're my disciples if you love one another. People know we are Christians. People know we're a part of this church. They know we're a part of this community that Christ has called us to because of the love we have for one another. And if we're that person that walks around running other people down, we're not representing Jesus well. That's not to say that person could be in complete wrong. It means that we're not representing Christ well because we don't have proper fellowship, because we don't have proper relationship with that person, because we're not building into the community that God has called us to build into. Bob said it this morning. I thought it was great. You need the church, and the church needs you. We got to have each other in our lives. We're all different, and I'm glad, right? We're all different people, and I'm thankful for that because I don't like hanging out with me sometimes, right? So I don't want like a church full of me's. Like that would be terrible. They could all be like my wife. That would be great too because she's the most amazing person ever. If you haven't met Melanie, she's awesome. But like, it's great that we're different. It's fantastic that we think different, that we act different, that we value different things. We're not all going to be on the same page all the time. I actually think that's okay. Because at the end of the day, we're one fellowship that has one mission, one purpose as a church, one goal. Man, that God's glory would be known in the substate, that we would see people commit to him. It's an amazing thing when a fellowship comes together, when you have that unique group. I'm not going to get nerdy and talk about Lord of the Rings, although that's where my mind's going. The Fellowship of the Ring, like they're all different. All right, so third thing. Prayer, verse 42, says they devoted themselves also to prayer. Prayer is one of those things that I think is often overlooked for us. Dependency on God is a core value for us as a church. That's something that we value, is something that we believe in. I think oftentimes prayer is something we miss out on because we forget that prayer is simply having a conversation with God. It's simply the fact that you are a priest and you have direct community with God. Think about the word communion, it's in community, right? That we have direct community with God in our lives. And prayer is that opportunity that we have to speak directly to him. I think a lot of times we get nervous. You ever been in a group and you're like, who wants to pray? And everybody's like staring at their shoes, like, somebody please raise their hand. Like everybody's terrified to raise their hand. I made it a personal goal of mine for years that whenever that happened, I would just be the first one to say yes, like immediately. If somebody's like, who would like to pray? I'd be like, me. Like to the point where they would get tired of me praying. But I mean, sometimes it's one of those things that can feel a little tiresome to us, when at the end of the day, prayer is simply having a conversation with God. I love it when I hear a student and they're just like, hey God, when they're praying, hey God, what's up? Like, this is my deal. And you're like, that's real. That's how you talk to people, right? Instead, a lot of times people change their voice when they pray. You ever notice that? Like, let's pray. Dear Father. And you're like, oh my goodness, where'd that come from? Talk to your wife that way. Come on. Like, this is weird prayer voice that happens. Prayer is simply having communion with God. The effective prayer of a righteous man accomplishes much. Have you prayed about it? Now, we have an incredible prayer ministry at our church. You have something you want some other people to pray for you about. We want to do that. We want to pray with you. All that stuff is confidential. You can pull out that Connect card. You can write on that Connect card. You can drop it in the prayer box over there. It goes to people who've been vetted and is confidential. They're not going to start posting that everywhere or calling their friends. Did you believe what this person said? Like, it's not going to happen because they're just going to pray for it because we value and believe in prayer. In fact, I would go to the point to say that you've sinned in your life if you haven't prayed about it first. I think it was D.L. Moody who said, I have so much to do today, I need to spend more time in prayer. For many of us, it feels the opposite. And I got such a busy life, I got so many things going on, I don't have time to pray. Man, if we want to be effective, we need to pray. The next thing is a move of God. In verse 43, back up to verse 43, it says, and awe came upon every soul, many signs and wonders were being done through the apostles. This is an amazing time in the life of the church because they did not have the complete word of God that we hold in our hands. They did not have that, right? The New Testament was still being developed, and so many signs and wonders were happening by the apostles in a way to validate really the move of God and what was happening. And so they saw God moving in lives. And you're like, Pat, well, those miracles are gone today. And I would say, no, they're not. God is still moving lives. In fact, we saw two students that came up here to get baptized this morning because God took a heart that was sinful and that was wretched and that was dead and that was walking away from God, and he radically changed them and made them a new creation, and now they're walking on a tight path following Jesus. That's a miracle. That's incredible. God is still changing lives all the time. I don't know when the last time you took a step of faith that was such that you needed God to show up and God to have bring a miracle in your life. I've had those times happen in my life, and I've seen God do amazing things. There was a time when Mel and I first got married, and we had auto draft on an account that we didn't know about, and found ourselves like $1,200 like in the red, and I was making $1,000 a month at my church part-time while I was in seminary, and driving 90 miles each way, so like it was impossible to try and fill that gap. And God showed up, and randomly, somebody gave us $1,200. Three people gave us $1,200. Randomly. God is in the miracle business still. I'm not saying I've got a glass of water I'm going to share, you know, sell you up here in the front or something. I'm saying God is in the miracle business. And a lot of times, we are afraid to see God moving. We know God is calling us to be the church and to share the gospel with somebody. We know God is calling us to go out of our comfort zone and ask somebody whether they know who Jesus is or whether we can explain the gospel to them or just love them in some way that seems supernatural, because it doesn't seem natural sometimes for us to love people that sometimes make us it's a little difficult to love. You know those people, right? Okay, and so we need to go out of our comfort zone to love those people because we want to see God move. Our children's minister here at our church, his dad was a college pastor at my last church, Josh Pratt. His dad's name is Sky, and I heard Sky say this: complainers aren't difference makers. Complainers aren't difference makers. How many times have we sometimes made complaints or regrets instead of just jumping in with what God's already doing in our world and saying, I'm going to leave the rest up to God. I'm going to leave the rest up to Him. I believe that God is still moving, and we need to be looking for that. We need to be jumping in where God is moving. We need to be willing to be a part of that conversation. The next thing is compassion in verses 44 and 45. He says, and all who believed were together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing them, the proceeds to all as any had need. This was not some form of communism that they all felt like everybody needs to put all their stuff in one bucket and then we're going to distribute it out as need. This was the church coming together realizing that we need each other for a reason. I'll say this about First Baptist Simpsonville, just bragging on First Baptist Simpsonville. I've never been in a church that loves other people better than we love people in that sense. A tree will go down in a storm or a tornado will come, and like within hours, there are people in our church with chainsaws, like your friendly neighborhood chainsaw guy, like, hey man, just cutting this tree down for you. It's good to see you. You know, glad you're part of our church. It's amazing how many people we have in our church that are ready to be mobilized, that are ready to show compassion, that are ready to love other people. Jesus showed up the religious system because the religious system of the day was, like I said, these priests that kind of felt like, in some ways, they were holier than the people around them, these Pharisees who felt like we know more than other people. And Jesus is like, it's not a us and them thing. It's let's bring people together so that we are a part of a community. In fact, another core value of ours, as far as compassion, is generosity. We give generously. It's not we give because we have to. It's not we give because somebody's going to come knock on my door later and ask me, did I give? We give generously because of what Jesus has done for us generously. He's loved us so much. We have compassion for the other people around us. When I meet a Christian that won't forgive other people, I have to think that maybe they haven't experienced forgiveness themselves. You're marked as a Christian by your love for others. The compassion that you have for other people shows the compassion that Christ has shown us through the cross. Philippians 2:4, each of you should look not only to your own interests, but to the interests of others. In fact, one of our summer interns this summer put on her Instagram, I thought really cool, said, God's love for us shows us how to love in a way that puts others first. We as a church need to be a compassionate church. I got two more things for you and then we'll close. Consistency. God, through this church, challenged them to be consistent. It says, and day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received with glad hearts. Consistency. Hebrews 10:25 says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. It's important to be a part of a body. It's important to be present. It's important to be active. I don't think there's anybody that's sitting on Monday morning that I'm aware of and going through a list to see who wasn't here so that we can pray for your soul or anything like that. But being a part of a community is important. Being consistent, being faithful. It's important. We need you, and you need the church. Our goal is to become more like Jesus. It's a big word you read in Scripture called sanctification. It's becoming more like Jesus every day. And we become more like Jesus every day as we get to know him personally and as we engage in community consistently. And the last thing is, in verse 47, is mission. They were marked by mission. It said, and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. It was a very normal part of their life to meet somebody whose life had just been changed by Jesus, had just been changed by the truth of the gospel. That was a normal part of their life. Another core value of ours, multiplication. Wayne did not ask me to share about all the core values, but another core value of ours, multiplication. We believe that God has called us as a church to be on mission. He's called us to engage with the mission of God. He's called us to be compelled by the love that he showed us. At the end of the day, the gospel is, simply put, God doing for us what we cannot do for ourselves. It's the fact that we on our own are sinners. We on our own are incapable of being perfect. We're incapable of having community with God because God is perfect and holy, and we are not. We are sinful. I don't think I have to convince a single person in this room that we're sinful, because we are. We all choose the wrong thing. Sin is anything we think, say, or do that disobeys God. We all have done that, probably this morning. And so the beauty of the gospel is that Jesus, in our place, went to the cross. So that when God looks at us, he no longer sees us in our sin if we've decided to follow Jesus with our lives. He sees his son. We should be so motivated by that message. There should be nothing else that drives us, that excites us anymore. Like, I'm excited about the new Avengers Endgame. Like, not lying. Like, I'm super pumped about it. I'm not going to spoil myself, and I'm going to fight the crowds, and I'm going to go to it. I'm excited. But nothing excites me more than the gospel. Nothing excites me more than when somebody gets it. Nothing excites me more than when somebody's like, I realize that left alone to my own devices, I am headed to hell. But Jesus stood in my place so that I could experience heaven forever with him. That's the beauty of the gospel. Not that we're good enough, not that we have to try harder, but man, that we would surrender ourselves and engage in the mission of God, that we would love him the way that these early Christians loved each other, and that we would learn from them and be marked by these same things, and that our community would know us by our love for one another. Let me pray for us. Father, I pray right now for our church that you would challenge us to move forward as a community, that those who aren't engaged in a connect group already would find an opportunity to engage in a connect group, to be face-to-face with other people that are going to look them in the eye and ask them how their walk is going. God, I pray for the person in this room that maybe hasn't even understood the need for community, that church has been something they've done instead of something that they've been. Help us to be the church, not go to church. God, help us to understand what it means to embrace a community, to love a community, for a community to challenge us. God, I pray for you to move in hearts this morning, that you would move in my heart this morning, that every single one of us would leave this place different and changed. Father, I love you, and I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I encourage you to respond as we sing our final song. And if you want to come up and pray, you're welcome to pray. I'll be up in the front. Some of our other ministers will be up here in the front as well. I'd love to talk to you if you want to make a decision for Christ. There's nothing that would excite me more than somebody willing to make a decision. But I want to encourage all of us, regardless, that this song would be a banner for us as we leave this place. It's going to lead into our next series, which I'm real excited about, even after this one, as we lead up to Easter. And man, God is doing some amazing things in the life of our church, so join me.